have a saying in my city that I hear all the time. It comes up in conversation whenever you're chatting with somebody and there's a mutual pain point in life. The saying is, the struggle is real. I was in traffic for an hour, the struggle is real. Winter is dragging on and on, the struggle is real. Underneath that popular cliche is a dark comedy over the fact that life, as good and rich as it is full of suffering and pain. No matter how much money you make or success you achieve, no life is up and to the right nonstop. At times, it is just a struggle to keep on. Jesus said as much. In John's gospel, Jesus said, "In this world, you will have trouble." Will have trouble, not are likely to, or it's theoretically possible. No, you will have trouble. Jesus and the New Testament writers go on to command us all through the New Testament to rejoice, meaning to choose joy. Why? It's an odd command, right? A command to be happy? Because in this world, suffering is inevitable, but joy is not. Of course, all sorts of wise teachers differentiate between pain and suffering. Pain is what is, the death of a loved one, or a diagnosis, or a divorce, or a failure, or a betrayal that you just can't shake. Suffering is how we feel about what is, and the meaning we make or we don't make from it. Psychologists define neuroticism as when we suffer more than we need to. By that definition, a lot of us are neurotic. We suffer more than we need to, in large part because we expect life to be easy. M. Scott Peck, if you're familiar with him, in his best-selling book, The Road Less Traveled, opens with this very simple line, "Life is difficult." And then he goes on for a few pages just to argue that when you expect life to be easy, it's really hard and you suffer and feel pain. But when you expect life to be hard, for the most part, in a counterintuitive way, it's very good and you are, not always, but a lot of the time, full of joy. And nowhere is this more true than in the spiritual life. Spirituality is a kind of struggle for our soul. Now, our generation is very uncomfortable with struggle in general and military metaphors and faith in particular, and for good reason if you've ever read church history. But the New Testament authors do not share our kind of fear of that metaphor. Over and over, they liken following Jesus not only to a struggle, but to a kind of war for the soul. Paul, the most prolific writer in the New Testament, says, "Fight the good fight of faith," a famous line. He also writes, "Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." He's very careful to note that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual forces of evil. And he goes on to say, the weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world, and we have divine power to demolish strongholds. That's all like rife military imagery from the ancient world. If you know your church history, you know there's an ancient stream of the church that developed around this spirituality of struggle and even spiritual war. It started with the desert fathers and mothers. The 3rd and 4th centuries were a defining moment for the church, the global church, not just the Western church. On one hand, Emperor Constantine, if you know your history, legalized the way of Jesus, or what by the 2nd century had come to be called Christianity. And the church kind of lost its prophetic edge. It began more and more to compromise with Rome and become complicit in a system that at times was very un-Christian. On the other hand, Rome, the empire, was in decline and disarray, and it felt like the world was falling apart at the seams. Thousands of followers of Jesus, as a response to this kind of cultural moment, gave up a, quote, normal life and moved out to the deserts of Egypt or Syria to devote their entire life to God in prayer. One such desert father was a hero of mine, a man named Evagrius Ponticus, also known as Evagrius the Solitary, which is pretty great. He was a wealthy intellectual from Constantinople in what is now Turkey, who abandoned his life of privilege for the desert of Egypt and just, again, gave his whole life over to prayer. In time, he became a sought-after spiritual guide and healer for the soul that other monks and nuns and followers of Jesus would come from all over the ancient Mediterranean to sit at his feet and sit under his teaching. His writings have survived as some of the most brilliant theology of the ancient church. My favorite is a book by his called Talking Back, A Monastic Handbook for Combating Demons, which is the best subtitle ever. It's an articulation of the Desert Fathers and Mothers' view of spirituality and prayer as a kind of struggle with the devil and other forces of evil. They were motivated to go into the desert and pray based on the story in Matthew 4 of Jesus going into the desert to pray and do what? If you know your Bible, fight the devil kind of head on. For them, silence and solitude wasn't a kind of Sabbath for the soul. It wasn't like a spiritual kind of day spa or an emotional place to kind of rest a bit and recoup from the big bad world. It was a war zone. They read Matthew 4, the story of Jesus and the devil in the desert, and pointed out that it reads very different than a lot of us would expect. It reads like the devil is speaking a lie over Jesus, and Jesus is refusing to hear or listen or believe that lie. Instead, what does Jesus do? He's turning his mind to a corresponding truth from Scripture, which for these ancient Christians was not like a form of Christian magic incantation or even a Bible study. The point wasn't memorize more of the Bible, though that's a great idea. What Jesus was doing, they said, was kind of curating his mind stream and even his consciousness to attune to the truth of God and not listen to or believe the lies of the enemy. Evagrius said our struggle in spirituality and in life as a whole is with three basic enemies. One was what he called the logosmai, which is a Greek word, you don't need to remember it. And it translates into English as thoughts or thought patterns or internal narratives. It's kind of the videos that play in all of our mind and imagination, kind of all through the day and the week. Just these videos, these thought patterns that go about who God is or about who we are or about what the good life actually is. Today, we would call a lot of the logosmai toxic thoughts or negative rumination is the word used by psychologists. Now, Evagrius believed that these logosmai were not just thoughts. They were thoughts that were at some level animated by demons that are speaking to us just as the devil was speaking to Jesus. Now, that may sound crazy to you, but just suspend judgment for a minute, kind of open your mind, take a deep breath. Have you ever had a thought that was toxic and it felt like it had a will to it? And a malignant will, it was like after evil in your soul, like it wanted to be thought, like it was trying to force its way into your mind and kind of take over your thought life and consume the video stream in your imagination. That no matter how hard you tried to resist it, it just kept coming back at you, almost like it was haunting you. Evagrius and the Desert Fathers and Mothers would say, that's because there is likely a demonic force behind that thought. They would say your mind is your primary contact point with reality itself and with God. So where does the devil aim his fiercest attack? At your mind. Now, whether you interpret your kind of toxic thoughts as demonically animated logosmai or just as toxic thoughts, or as an evolutionary psychologist would argue that, you know, your brain is hardwired to scan the horizon for threats, and so you're bent toward negative thinking, whatever. Either way, the result is our mind, rather than a place of peace under the rule and reign of Jesus in the kingdom, is often a battleground between truth and lies, between peace and all sorts of other things, between thoughts that lead to death and thoughts that lead to life. The next enemy that Evagrius identified after the logosmai or your thoughts or these lies that we believe was what he and the Desert Fathers and Mothers called the passions, or in New Testament language, the flesh. This is like, we'll talk more about this soon, but this is like our animal kind of desires that take over our heart and in time control our behavior. And then the last was the world itself, which Evagrius and thousands of early Christians literally ran away from to escape in the desert, its corruption on the soul. Now, over the centuries, these three enemies of the soul, as they came to be called, were codified into this three-part kind of enemies of the soul: the world, the flesh, and the devil, which were kind of like a counter-trinity to God himself, hell-bent on the ruin of your soul and our society. This paradigm of the three enemies of the soul was used for over 1,000 years and still is in a lot of the church. But our generation in the West has, for the most part, left it behind as a forgotten relic from the past. We laugh at the idea of the devil as a pre-modern, pre-scientific myth, a kind of hangover from a superstitious past. We scratch our heads at the idea of the flesh in a sensual culture where feeling good is a much higher value for most people than being good. And we don't even have a category for the world. We prefer to call it culture or the arts or economics or politics. And yet, it is my conviction that all three enemies of the soul are alive and well, and aided by our skepticism, are wreaking havoc right and left in us and in the people around us. The intent of this book and the sessions that we're about to travel through together is to update this ancient paradigm of the world, the flesh, and the devil for our secular and more sophisticated kind of cultural moment. Here's my working theory. As followers of Jesus, we are at war with the world and the flesh and the devil. And the three enemies' kind of strategy against us is as follows: deceptive ideas, the devil, more on that soon, that play to disordered desires, the flesh, that are normalized in a sinful society, the world. Over the next three sessions, the plan is to go deep on each of the three enemies, not to rally kind of a digital militia to take America back for God, not my heart at all, take a deep breath. Our culture is more divided than it's ever been before in my life, and I have no desire to pour gas on the fire. Rather, as the Chinese philosopher Sun Tzu once said, know your enemy. There's wisdom in that. To recognize our enemies in order to resist our enemies. Because if we don't recognize the enemy of the devil, we will end up demonizing people or even entire groups of people instead, or just dealing with the symptoms and not with the root problem. Now, all of this may sound unbelievable to you. That's just fine. I invite you to come along with an open mind and a tender heart. What if we're neurotic? What if we suffer more than we need to because we expect life to feel like a picnic when in reality we're born in the middle of a war zone? What if life is by definition a kind of struggle? What if that struggle is actually a good thing? What if it's a part of our formation into people not only of strength, but of love? What if our generation and our secular Western kind of culture is blind to a whole dimension of reality? What if the ancients, and honestly, most people in the world today outside of the West, were and still are more in tune with the full spectrum of reality than we are? What if there's more than synapses firing in our brain in response to stimuli in our environment? What if we have a soul? And what if it's under assault? And a war is raging over its future. Martin Luther King Jr. once said that inside all of us is an internal civil war that is just raging between truth and lies, the spirit and the flesh, the kingdom of God and the world. But the good news or the gospel is that this internal war doesn't have to be a tug of war with both sides kind of locked in a struggle forever, a kind of war of attrition until you're exhausted and burned out. Through Jesus, through following him and apprenticing under his teaching, we can come to peace. In the language of the civil rights era hymn, that beautiful line, we shall overcome.